Good morning.
Good morning.
Savior.
Sure good to be here in the house of the Lord today. Today that He's given us to come together to worship and to serve Him. I know you've been praying for Brother Roger. He needed this vacation.
Amen.
Very bad. And I'll tell you one thing, you are very, very fortunate to have a pastor like Roger.
Amen.
I mean, really. I'm not just saying that. First come here is your pastor, and he's a pastor, he's a preacher. You don't get that with everybody.
Amen.
But he's a pastor and he's a preacher, and he proclaims the word of God.
Amen.
And he
Amen.
Gives it to us. And you know, I pastored for years and years, and I have enjoyed sitting right back there in my pew. Don't anybody ever get in my pew. So I really enjoyed sitting back there and just being fed. It's different than being up here trying to feed people. But it's sitting there, and I have really, really, my wife and I, Linda, we have really enjoyed just hearing the word of God. And as I said, he is a man of God.
Amen.
I mean a man of God. And I appreciate him. He'll be back next Sunday. Probably ready for him to be back. But anyway, he'll be back next Sunday, and I don't know what time this week he'll be coming home. And but anyway, my prayer is that he's had a relaxing time with family.
Amen.
And when he comes back, he'll be ready to go. I know that. And he wasn't ready to leave. But anyway, this morning, I want us to think about a new day is dawning. A new day is dawning. Every day is a new day. And let's think about this. It's going to be in the book of Joshua. And I want us just to think about some of the outcome up to this time. God prepared Moses to go in and to bring the Israelites out of Egypt, so that they could come. And they went through all kinds of things. And Moses did exactly what God had called him to do. He brought them out. And he come to a place. And they had been given opportunity for the promised land. And that's what he had done during that time. And we know in Numbers, we know in 13, it tells us about the Lord spoke to Moses, saying to him, send men to spy out this new promised land. And we know they sent out the 12. And what happened was, when the 12 came back, there was 10 of them that said, we can't do this. We cannot go into the promised land. We cannot. They are giants there. We're like grasshoppers. But Joshua and Caleb said, we can go because the Lord has said we can go.
Amen.
And that was really what had happened during that time. And then in Joshua chapter 1, it said, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying to him, Moses, my servant is dead. Now therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given you, as I have said to Moses. And you think about what he's saying here. Now, Joshua, you're taking charge. You're in charge now. And I'm going to work through you to see that they enter into the promised land. And then we go over into the third chapter of Joshua. And I'm going to ask you to stand as we read this scripture this morning. Beginning with verse 1. Then Joshua rose early in the morning, and they set out from Achaia Grove and came to the Jordan, he and all the children of Israel, and lodged there before they crossed over. So it was, after 3 days, that the officers went through the camp, and they commanded the people, saying, When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priest, the Levites, bringing it, bearing it, then you shall set out from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, and 2,000 cubits by measure. Do not come near it, that you may know the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way before. Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, and we thank you for Joshua. We thank you for Moses. We thank you for all of those that we study about and learn about and their life, and we can just read and understand the history and the things that went on in the Bible, Lord. And we pray this morning, Lord, that just for a few moments, that you just give us an insight of our life and the way that we live and the things that we do. Lord, just take charge of this service today. Just get me out of the way. Lift this prayer in your name. Amen. You may be seated. We notice in this that the Lord gave Joshua specific instructions. Exactly how he was to do it and what he was to do, because he was going to be the leader now. And a leader has to have instructions and know what to do. And that's what he was giving to Joshua during this time. And he said that they were following the covenant through the Jordan River. And you know, the same thing happened in the Jordan River as it did in the Red Sea when they came. The waters were parted. It stopped. Nothing was moving, and they went through on dry ground. And you just think about, I mean, this is something that God has given us to think about. What I want us to do, now we know the story, we know the outcome and all the things that are going on because it's in the Word and we've studied and we've looked at it. But this morning, what I want us to do for just a few moments, I want us to apply these words, for you have not passed this way before. You've not passed the way that you're going to pass even today, because you don't know what's going to happen before the day's over. Now, when we get up in the morning, we have certain things that we're going to do. We're going to get up. I get up in the morning. I pick up my hearing aids. I wear hearing aids. I'm old enough to do that. But I pick up my hearing aids, and then I go and I get me a cup of coffee. But what do I do before I get the coffee? I take my medicine. You do, some of you do, some of you don't. I know a man that's up in his 90s, and he's told me, said, I've never taken any medicine in my life but aspirin. Boy, I tell you what, I'm envious of him. I mean, he doesn't have to take medicine. I have to take it, and many of you have to take it. So we have our routine that we go through every morning, it's the same thing. But what I want to talk about today is, we have not passed this way before, because there's things that are going to happen that only God knows. Only God knows what's going to happen to each and every one of us, even this afternoon. He knows what's going to happen even maybe before this service is over to some of us. You know, Jesus could come back. And he knows it. And he knows exactly what's going on. So I want us to apply these words to each and every one of our lives today. You know, for years and years being a pastor, I would always take this passage of scripture at the new year, and I would say to the church now, you know, you've not passed this way before, and it's going to happen. But you know, I finally realized that it wasn't just a new year service and a message. It was every day. You realize that? Every day. Because we have not passed this way before. And so we realize that. But though it's very important for us to know the way that we must go, for we've not been. Now, what if? I'm going to give you a what if this morning. What if the night before, when we got ready to go to bed and we laid down, the Lord would say, Royce, now tomorrow, this and this and this and this is going to happen. Would that be good? No, it wouldn't be good, because what would happen is, I would worry all night long about what he had given me and told me that he wanted me to do. I'd worry. And you would too, if you knew what was going to happen tomorrow. Because he could say, okay, tomorrow I'm going to put somebody in your life that doesn't know Christ as personal Savior. Wow, what would I do? I would think, you know, what am I going to say? How am I going to react? What am I going to do when I meet this person that I do not know that is not a Christian? How am I going to share with them? And I would worry about this all night, probably wouldn't get any sleep. And I would wait till tomorrow, and then whenever it come time, I would try to depend on me to share the gospel, salvation, and not what the Lord give to me. You realize that your testimony as a child of God, your testimony is very important. Sometimes we try to give other people's great testimonies that we've heard, you know, of how the Lord worked in their life. But you realize that your testimony is the best thing that you can share. Why? Because you were there when Jesus Christ saved you. He gave you that new life. He gave you the way. So what if? We don't want the what if, do we? We just want to know. We want the Lord to give to us each and every day what he's going to do. Psalm 118:24 says, this is the day the Lord has made. The last message that I preached here, brought, was on this is the day. And this is the day. But not only this is the day, it's a new day is dawning. Because the Lord has given us this day. He has worked with us. Each day that God gives us, it's a challenge before us. A challenge that God lays out. So how are we going to meet that challenge? Are we going to try to take care of ourselves? Are we going to trust the Lord because he has challenged us? And you know, I believe that God never, ever, ever gives us something to do that he does not prepare us for. I believe that with all my heart, because there's things that God has done and has given to me that I know that if God had not been in it, I could have never done it. I could have never done it because God had to be in charge. God had to be the one that shared with me what to do, because there's things that happen from day to day and time to time that we're talking about, because it's a new day. It's a new start. It's a new beginning. And we all desire this kind of day that we can understand and know what God is saying. Now in Isaiah, the book of Isaiah, these words are penned. But now, thus saith the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, and who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. Isaiah 43:1. And then down in Isaiah 43:18, the Lord was talking, was giving to Isaiah, was sharing with them what the Lord had said. And he shared with him all these things in between that time that had happened and was going to happen and everything. And then here's what he said in verse 18. He said, do not remember the former things. Don't remember them, nor consider the things of old. Isaiah 43:19, he said, Behold, I am about to do a new thing. Now he said to me, I'm doing a new thing. So what does that mean? That we need to look, we need to see what God is doing. You know, it's very important that we see what God is doing. He wants us to see. He wants us to understand. The same promise that he gave to Isaiah to share that day is with us today. Behold, I am about to do a new thing in your life. Now, what is this new thing? You don't know. I don't know. But here's what I have to do. I have to be ready. So when I wake in the morning, what do I need to do? Before I even get up in the morning, I need to pray. I need to talk with my Lord. I need to talk with him and ask him, what would you have me to do today? Who are you going to bring in my life, in my pathway, that I need to maybe minister to? And maybe sometime they minister to me because of things that happened in my life. What are you going to do, Lord? And I have to be willing whenever I ask him and he shared with me, not right then. He's not going to say, okay, you've asked me what you're going to do today or what I'm going to give to you today. He doesn't give me an outline. See what he tells me. He says, be ready. Be ready. And what does that mean? That I have to be ready at all times for every circumstance, for everything that come before me, and every person that come before me. I need to be ready for whatever the Lord has for me to do. And you do too. Every one of you. As a child of God, you need to be ready. How are you going to be ready? You're going to ask the Lord to make you ready. And then whenever He does, He's going to give you exactly what you need to know, what you need to do, and how you need to do it. I mean, nothing left undone. God doesn't leave anything undone whenever it comes to that. The prophet Jeremiah shared in Lamentations 3, 22 and 23. Here's what he shared. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's love never ceases. Do you realize that? Never. And then he goes on to say his mercies never come to an end. He's always willing to give to us the things we need. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Every day, every moment, God's love is forever and forever. For you and for me. I believe there's an urgency of the hour. I believe the Lord has many things that He wants us to do. One thing He wants us to do is we need to announce His word. That means that we need to make known publicly, and we need to proclaim. If I'm a Christian, I need to proclaim that I'm a Christian. And not only that, I need to live as if I'm a Christian. Not just proclaim it. I need to live it so that people will know and understand. And then we need to live His word. And that is to have life, be alive. You know, God doesn't expect us to go around kind of upset all the time or kind of down and out and sad looking. What He wants us to do as Christians, He wants us to be alive so that people see us, they know that we're alive. That there's something that lives in us. There's someone that lives in us that gives us that life and that way that God has given to each of us. And then another one is to explain His word. And that's to make known in detail. Have you ever had somebody ask you a question about the Bible? And they wanted you to explain it in detail to them? And you did? But let me tell you, there's sometimes that we can't explain it in detail. And here's the thing. If you can't explain it in detail, you don't try to explain it in detail. You say, you know, I really don't know, but I'll find out. Because we don't want to put on something and tell somebody something that we really don't know what we're talking about. And God doesn't expect us to. And we don't, you know, we know a lot. We're smart people, we think. We know a lot, but we don't know everything. And God knows that, and God understands that. And then we're to share His word. And that is to tell others about the love of Christ that everybody knows it. Everyone wants to be a success. No one wants to be a loser. You realize that? But the world remembers a winner and forgets a loser. You realize that? People remember winners, but they forget about losers and things. Each of us has won battles, and let us thank God for them and give Him a better service. But each of us also has lost battles, and let us thank God for another chance, a better chance that God has given us. The dictionary says that to succeed is to accomplish what is attempted. Accomplish what is attempted is what the dictionary shares with us. So the Christian has the right objective when he wants to be prosperous, when he wants to be successful, when he wants to be happy. But this is not for himself. This is for God. You realize that? When you work for the Lord, you're doing it for His glory and not for your glory. I've seen people before that have done things and they didn't get the glory and they would be mad about it, upset. No, that's not the way we're supposed to be. We are supposed to be doing the things for the glory of God.
Amen.
And That's for him, not for us. I believe God wants us to be successful. He wants us to be magnificent and not mediocre. He wants us to be strong. He wants us to be radiant, jubilant Christians instead of discouraged and discontented pilgrims. He wants us to be full of hope and praise and love and peace and power and not bound down with all these cares and woes that we have. See, sometimes we get so bound down that we're held down and we can't serve the Lord because of our life and the things that's in it that God has, that God can take care of if we just let Him when it comes to that. I believe God wants us to be happy in heart and prosperous in the things of life. I believe that with all my heart. God promises both of these if we will follow Him. The whole secret lies in putting God first. In Matthew chapter 6, we find in this passage of scripture, Jesus speaks about the material things. He speaks about food. He speaks about raiment and all the needed things of life. But down in verse 33 and 34, we find these words. It said, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." It didn't say that they're going to be added. It said that you've got to seek. You have to seek for them to be added. You have to want them to be added. And then He goes on to say, "Therefore, do not worry." "Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own self." I know none of you worry. Some of you may be worried right now about something. But here's the thing. We don't need to be worried, people. We need to trust the Lord. But you know, that verse didn't end right there. I didn't put the rest of it, but I should have. Here's what it says. "Sufficient for the day is it trouble." Sufficient for the day for its own trouble. That means that there's going to be trouble. It's going to be adequate without you worrying about it. And it means also that it's going to be enough that you don't have to worry about and add to it, see. Because that's what the Lord gives to each and every one of us. I believe God will give us everything we need and cause our heart to sing with joy if we give Him first place. First place in our life. Being faithful to the Master is essential. Now when a cook bakes a cake or whatever, they must put certain ingredients into it in the right amount. Now, since I've retired, Linda has let me do a little cooking. So, the first cookies that I made, I got mixed up on the ingredients, on the amount. Well, I knew it had Crisco, but I looked at this little thing on Crisco and I got mixed up on, and I doubled it. I looked at margarine and I got mixed up on margarine because I didn't look at the little slots on the margarine. You don't have to tell you how much. So I doubled it. So when the cookies were done, boy, I was real happy and real proud of them. And when they cooled, you could touch them and they fell apart. You couldn't eat them because, they just didn't have the right ingredients. So the thing about it is, you have to have the right ingredient. So if we are to have a prosperous and happy life, we have to achieve certain ingredients given by the example of Christ. He is our example. We look in the Word and we can see it. And I want to call your attention to a couple of these ingredients this morning. The Bible must have a place in our life. Realize that? It's got to have a place in our life if we are Christians and we call ourselves Christians. It's a sweet book to live by, and it's a sweet book to die by. The Bible gives us the Word. We can build our life on the Bible with assurance that the Father has promised us whatever he promised, whatever he's promised to give to us, in his word, we can be assured that that's exactly what is going to happen. And that's what he wants it to be. Paul, in writing to the Ephesians chapter 1, he said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places." Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. What? Every. Not just one or two or three, but every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. He wants to bless us. He wants to give to us the way that we are. He does not want us to be down and out. He wants us to be up and about. I mean, he wants us to do the things that he has called us to do and set us aside to do. And let me tell you, people, if we're not doing what God wants us to do, we are not happy. Right? We are not happy because God wants us to be happy. He wants us to be prosperous. He wants us to do the things that he has actually called us to do. And then here's another promise that we have in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. It says, "In whom ye also trusted." Now, I'm going to ask you, I want you to take your Bible this morning, and I want you to turn to that passage of Scripture, Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 13. And I want you to think with me for a few moments about this passage of Scripture, which is very, very important. And if you do not have this underlined or marked in your Bible, you need to think about it. But here's the thing. In this passage of Scripture, it gives us eternal life. Now, there's people that will tell you that you can be saved today and lost tomorrow. Not so, says God. Not so. Christ died for us one time on the cross of Calvary. One time, not two or three or four or five. And whenever we were saved, he gave us a new life one time. Now, I'm not saying that everybody lives like Christians that are Christians, but one day they will enter to the Lord if they're a child of God and they're not living it, because we're only saved once. Now, I had a problem for several years thinking about, what if somebody asked me how I know for sure that when I'm saved forever? Here's the answer. It said that we who first trusted in Christ, verse 12, that we who first trusted in Christ should be to the praise of his glory. In him you also trusted. After that you heard what we heard, the word of God, the truth or the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, here it is, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory.
Amen.
Underline that, and if somebody asks you how you know that you're saved and you're saved forever, you take it there, because you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, and it will never change. You're there forever and forever. Oh, I love that verse. Sealed by the Holy Spirit of promise, who is a guarantee of our inheritance. Yes, we are inherited things. God has given us an inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. Man, that is strong stuff. That is really strong stuff. That should be the most exciting promise from our Heavenly Father to us today, being sealed. When a builder takes a level and places it on a piece of lumber and finds that the lumber is not straight, he doesn't throw the level away, he straightens the lumber. You realize that? And also, one of the best uses of the Bible is to help in straightening out our lives. You realize that? but it'll straighten it out. Sometime more than we want to be straightened out, because we have to yield to the Lord as to what the Lord is doing and giving to each and every one of us. So when we read the Bible and we see that our lives are not measuring up to God's Word, we're not to discard the Bible and forget about what we're supposed to do. We're to straighten up our lives. That is the answer right there that God has given to each of us. And another thing, prayer is essential for the spiritual life that God has given us. When do we really get serious in prayer to the Father? Now think with me for a moment. Sometimes we try to do things, we try to take care of things ourselves. And then when the going really gets tough, what do? We say, you know, I haven't prayed yet. I haven't asked God. And all the time, God is waiting. He knows our situation. He's waiting for us to call upon Him so that He can meet our needs. He can meet all the needs that we have. And all He's doing is waiting. He said, hear me, Christian. Hear me, believer. Hear me, child of God. I'm wanting to do something, and you're trying to do it yourself, and you can't do it. You know, sometimes we get things in such a big mess, I think it's hard for God to even straighten out. Because we really do. We get them there, and then whenever we come to the time when we say, Lord, Lord. He said, I've been waiting all this time. I've been here, not pushing you. I'm waiting on you to come and do the things that needs to be done. Luke 11:9, that we find, says these words, Dr. Luke said, and he said, and I say unto you, ask, and it shall be given you, seek, and ye shall find, knock, and it shall be opened unto you. He said this, ask, and seek, and knock, for everyone, you hear what I'm saying? Everyone, what I said a while ago, that sometimes we will not ask, we will not seek, we will not knock. But he said, for everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and him who knocks it will be opened. What are we waiting on? God wants us. A new day dawns every morning. He wants us to seek the things. He wants us to ask Him. He wants us to come before Him. What are we waiting on? Some of the things that we do, we wonder why we do them. God probably wonders why we do them too. To have physical life, we must breathe the air that God gives us. You know, when it gets hard and people, you see them with oxygen trying to breathe and all. That is the physical life that we have. But to have a spiritual life, we must pray. 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 Prayer is essential in our Christian life. Do you realize that when you were saved, you had to pray? You had to ask God to come into your heart and save you. He just didn't come in because you thought, well, I need Him. You asked Him. And then prayer. How do we know what to do if we don't pray and we don't ask and we don't seek? How do we know what to do? We don't. We don't, people. We're just out there running just wild. We don't know what to do. But what I'm saying, when a new day is dawning and God is preparing us for that day, then that is what we're doing. We're waiting and we're waiting and we're seeing what God is doing and what He's going to do in our lives and what He wants to do. And then when it happens, it's there. Many times over the years, I've gone to families that's lost loved ones in tragic accidents. And I get a call, and they say that something has happened very, very tragic. I remember one time in a church where I pastored a family, we were having had a meal at church. We hadn't been there just a short time, a family. We had had a meal that evening, and some of them were cleaning up the kitchen and everything. And this lady was there, and I got a call from her son-in-law that her husband had got killed. And what happened, he had got hung in a hay baler, one of these does, you know, reach. And I thought, Lord, what am I going to say? What can I do when I get to this house? God, only you can give me the words, because I don't know what to say. And we went to that home. And I had to pray and share with this lady one of the hardest things that I ever did. But do you know, if I had not had God to speak to me and give me the words, I could have never done it. I give him the glory and the praise for many, many times, and you do too. When you've gone to places you didn't know what to say, when you got there, the Lord will give you the words. And what I'm trying to say, people, is we just need to get out of the way. We just need to get out of the way and let God use us and work through us. So we must pray. Look at some of the times that Jesus prayed. When he was popular and when he was unpopular. At his baptism, at his temptation, after his busiest day. All night, often in early hours, he was up. He would go up into the mountains and he would pray. When he fed the 5,000, he prayed. Oh, man, fed them, took these loaves and little fishes and fed 5,000 people with them, and then they gathered up all of these food. Prayer. He prayed because he needed to. He prayed in Gethsemane with the greatest agony ever known. Prayed on the cross of Calvary. He was there for you and for me, and he prayed there. And he dropped his head and said, "It is finished." If Jesus prayed as he did, how much more do we need to pray? He is our Savior. Remember, success is to accomplish what is attempted. What is attempted? What is attempted? What is attempted in our life today? The Lord gives to us what we are to attempt. You realize that? God gives to us what we are to attempt to do. There's a challenge. So to be successful for God is to put him first in everything. Everything. And if you can't put him first in everything, you need to do away with whatever that thing is. Because you've got to be first in everything. If you can't put him first in your job, where you're working, get another job. God wants to be first place in everything and everywhere that you are and what you do. Every day is a new day. New day is dawning every morning. Today is a day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. A new day is dawning. Behold, he said, I'm going to do something new for you today. You've never been this way before, but you're going to go this way because I'm going to give you this way. And I'm going to give you the strength and the power and the love and the compassion that you need to fulfill whatever I have given for you to do today. God only given to us. We're passing today, but we've never passed before. We're passing today, but we've never passed before. Maybe you're here today. Maybe you're a child of God. Maybe you brought some burdens with you today, some worries, some cares. You know what God wants? He wants you to give it to him right now. He says, give them to me. Give them to me. Let me take care of them for you. Don't try to take care of yourself. Let me take care of them for you. Because he said, I have the power and the strength to take care of them. I love you, he says. I don't want you to be unhappy. I don't want you to be hurt. And my grace is sufficient for you. Whatever. Whatever. Sometimes we don't understand this. You know? God's grace is sufficient. And maybe you're here today, and maybe you need to give him some of those things. Or maybe you're here today, and you've come without Jesus Christ in your heart. You have never come to the place in your life where you have asked Jesus to come into your heart and save you. Say, oh, I'll do that later. I'll do that. So says the Lord, today is the day of salvation. Not tomorrow. Today is the day. And the Lord called you, and people say, oh, I'll do that when I get ready. It says that the Holy Spirit pulls us to come and to know Christ. And you can't do it on your own. You can't do it on your own. You can't be saved on your own. I can't save you. Nobody can save you but the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for you on the cross of Calvary. And maybe you're here today, and maybe you don't know Christ as personal Savior. Let me tell you, he wants to come into your heart and save you right now. Right now. I'm going to have an invitation in just a moment. Brother Roger's going to come down. I'll be down here. And maybe you have a decision that you need to make today. Maybe you need to come to this altar. Maybe you need to pray and get right with God. Whatever you need to do today, do it now. A new day is coming. Let's stand. Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, and this is your invitation that you give to us. Each of us has an opportunity. And Lord, we know that you love us. You have compassion for us. We know that you care for us and that you want to work through our lives. And all we have to do is just be willing to turn loose and let you do this, Father, because you know exactly what you're doing and what you're going to do in our lives. You know every person that's here today. You know their life. You know their way, Father. And you know their heart. And you know if there's somebody here that's brought these burdens with them, that they need to give them to you. They need to get those burdens lifted off of their shoulder. And they need to trust you and believe in you and have faith in you. And if there's someone here today that's come without Jesus, my prayer is that they'll come to know him before they leave this service today. Right now is the time for them to come. Father, take care of this service. You give it to us. We ask this in your name.